Blessed is Mormon in Romans chapter 10, starting verse 5. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is, to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does he say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in one to whom they have not heard? And how are they to hear about someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The psalm this morning is Psalm 58. Let me hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace to his people, to his faithful, to those who turn to him in their hearts. Surely his salvation is at hand for those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Steadfast love and faithfulness will meet. Righteousness and peace will kiss each other. Faithfulness will spring up from the ground, and righteousness will look down from the sky. The Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness will go before him, and will make the path for his steps. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
Can tread water. and a slightly above-average pastor, and this covers most of us, that is the pastor who can recognize large bodies of water. That includes most of us. But the average pastor, many days I'm included in this, the average pastor can at least drink and or pass water. So now that I've told it, I realize that what a dumb joke that is. That's not a good joke. But it's true, even though it might be dumb. It is so true. And another version of the story I've heard is one told by bishops. And this is about all congregations that are looking for a pastor. They're in the pastoral call process, right? And they're describing what kind of pastor that they want versus who is actually available for them for a call. So in other words, most congregations want a pastor who can do what? Walk on water. But most congregations are going to get a pastor that can drink or at least pass water. That's just the reality of the situation. So walking on water, it's a miracle. There's no question about that. It's a miracle. No one but Jesus has ever been able to do it correctly. Peter tries. He tries. He has faith for a while, but he fails at walking on water. I think that's the first lesson we learned from our text this morning. Realistic expectations. Not just of pastors, but realistic expectations of ourselves, realistic expectations of our church staff, realistic expectations of our volunteer church workers, of our boards, of our councils, of our congregations. The church, our church, is less a place of perfection and more, as Luther rightly called it, a hospital for sinners. We are a hospital for sinners, where people can and do act pretty much in the same way as they do in every other aspect of human life. Perhaps we start out okay, like Peter, but then we notice the strong winds rising up around us, and we start to sink. And we cry out with that prayer that Peter cried out with, "Lord, save us. Lord, help us." Jesus, the helper, Jesus, the rescuer, he is the only one who can walk on water. And yet that should stop us from at least attempting to, from at least trying. Storm is raging. The waters are high. And the boat we thought was sturdy is really being tossed around. And we are being shown just how frail. We are being shown just how thin the veneer between us and the storm waged by hate really is in our world. And not only are we inside the storm, but the storm has made its way inside of us. Each one of us. And I know that several of you by now know the story of the tragic death of the woman named Heather Heyer, when a white racist drove his car into a crowd of protesters. The storm is raging. And also the death of Lieutenant Cullen and the trooper, Pilot Bates. They didn't get to go home to their families last week. Let me tell you a little bit about the horrific and terrifying events that happened in Charlottesville. One group arrived with members of the KKK and the neo-Nazis and the skinheads and other white supremacists who were shouting slogans like "blood and soil," which is a Nazi chant, blood and soil, and chants like, we will not be replaced. And then another group arrived last Friday night saying things like, racism is wrong, and God wants better and more for this country. And on Friday, the group of anti-racists gathered in a church, and there were many of our brothers and sisters in our denomination, the ELCA, that were gathered there. My colleagues, our bishops that were gathered there, our fellow members of the church were gathered there. They gathered to sing, and they gathered to pray, they gathered to worship, just like you and I woke up this morning to do, just like you and I. They gathered to worship. And that church became surrounded outside by these white supremacist groups with torches in their hands. And these worshipers were unallowed and unable to leave that church, to exit that church, because they were afraid for their lives when they gathered to worship. Is this the legacy? Is this the country that we want? Is it your legacy? Is it the country that you want to raise your children and to raise your grandchildren and to live in? We all need to ask ourselves these tough questions. The storm was raging last week, and the storm continues to rage. At the memorial service for his daughter, Mark Heyer said this: no father should have to do this. And he's right, isn't he? Isn't he right? No father should have to bury their child. And his voice was breaking as he spoke from the stage filled with flowers and smiling images of his daughter flashing on the screen behind him. He said she loved people and she wanted equality, he said. And on the day of her passing, she wanted to put down hate. To put down hate. And Heather's father recalled raising a defiant, a strong-willed, and a compassionate daughter who always argued with what she thought was right. And her mother, as she spoke at the memorial service, she said, I'd rather have my child. But by golly, if I got to give her up, we're going to make it count. She said, you remember that? If I got to give her up, by golly, we're going to make it count. So be careful when you teach your children. Justin, Carly, be careful what you teach Ashley. Be careful what you teach Emily. All of you, be careful what you teach your children. And be careful what you teach your grandchildren and the children in your neighborhood. Be careful. For when we parents offer our children up to the world to serve and to give and to go and to heal and to teach, when we have our children baptized in the faith, in the church, then we are giving them up so that they might proclaim Christ through word and deed. Did you hear those words that you promised this morning? That we will teach our children to proclaim Christ through word, through our deeds, to care for others in the world God made, and to work for justice and peace. Be careful what you teach your children. For we are giving them up to the faith when we baptize them, so that they will act and speak for justice and love and peace. They laid to rest this past week a young woman whose mother and father taught her to risk and to love and to work and to speak for justice and peace. So be careful what you do, moms. Be careful what you do, dads. You give your children to the world, and the world doesn't always spare them. So be careful. We share our children. We give them up. We share one another with the whole world. They do not belong to us. We nurture and we guide them along. We encourage them and we support them. And it's a good thing. Yes, it's a grand thing to share our lives and our children with the world. But the world can be dangerous when we teach our children to love and care for others in the world God made. The world can be dangerous when we teach them to work for justice and peace. It can be deadly. It is deadly, as the Heyer family found out. But it is good, and it is right. And I try to do the same with my own children, to send them off and to send them out to change the world, to take some risks, and hopefully to live dangerously. And to live in love, not hate. To live in peace, not division or conflict. Send them out to change the world and to take some risks for the sake of love and for the sake of Christ. And we all should do the same. I wondered in the midst of the Heyer's grief. I wondered in the midst of Heather's death that her parents could speak such powerful words at her memorial service. Perhaps it's because they too have been on the boat with Jesus, and they too have heard the waves crashing in on the boat. And perhaps it is because they know that in the midst of the raging storm that they have a God of abundant life and a God of an abundant love. And they can give up their beautiful daughter because they can see Jesus' hand extended out to her on the water so that she could work for justice and peace. Well, you and I, you can't walk on the water. Neither can I. We can't walk on the water, but we are called by the same Jesus in the midst of this raging storm. You are called. After all we do, as Paul puts it so well, all of us have beautiful feet. We are called to walk with those beautiful feet. Not feet that are in conflict. Not feet that are carrying around torches in their hands and weapons in their hands, keeping people from leaving a church while they are worshiping. You are called to walk with beautiful feet. Feet which are made beautiful in Jesus. Feet which reflect Jesus' way and the will of the one water walker to take our beautiful feet and to follow him. To follow him in love and in peace and in justice. Now there is a saying attributed to Dietrich Bonhoeffer, a Lutheran pastor in Germany who was executed for his role attempting to overthrow the Nazi regime. This is the quote attributed to Dietrich Bonhoeffer, Pastor Bonhoeffer. Silence in the face of evil is itself evil. Silence is evil. So do not dare be silent in the midst of hatred. Do not be silent. God will not hold us guiltless. Not to speak is to speak, and not to act is to act, as Dietrich Bonhoeffer said. So speak and act and use those beautiful feet that the Lord has given you to fight against racism, to fight against hatred, to fight against discrimination in this world and in this church. The storm is as strong as ever, and if we're willing, the one who walks on the waves, the one who is unmoved by the storm, will command us to do the impossible, to stand with our beautiful feet against all forms of hatred, to stand with our beautiful feet against discrimination, to stand with our beautiful feet for justice and for peace and for love, to stand with our beautiful feet as a church that belongs to Christ, where there is a place for everyone, and to stand with our beautiful feet as Christ's church. And as Christ's church, it is not our church to control. It is not ours to sort. It is not ours to divide. It is not ours to categorize. It is not ours to exclude. To stand with our beautiful feet and to send our children and to send our grandchildren in the faith to do the same. To teach them so that they will speak and they will act. If we are going to put distance between the ugly disease of racism and hate in our country, in your country, then we are going to have to stand and speak and forbid it to come any closer to our children and our grandchildren. We're going to have to forbid it, this disease called hatred and racism, to claim the lives of any more of our children, your children.